So, hello guys, today I would be going to discuss the Art Coder Beginner Contest 228. So, the first problem starts with on and off. Basically, here you would be given with two timers, S and T, where S denotes the start time and T denotes the end time of switching on and switching off the some bulb or something. And you have to find out whether that bulb is on for 30 minutes from the time given. So, let me just iterate it in short. So, suppose two times given are S and T. Suppose they are of 10 a.m. in the morning and till 23, that is 11 p.m. in the night. So suppose the timer is between any time in between these two times, that is from 10 till 22, then the answer would be definitely yes. And this is the case when T is greater than S. Now, when S is greater than T, that is suppose the time the bulb has been switched on 4 p.m. in the evening, that is at 16, and has been switched off on the 14th on next day, that is 2 o'clock. So for this to happen, the timer has to be greater than 16 and should be definitely less than 14. So that is the case. And now let us just move to the code and see it. So just input three variables. If the timer is greater than A, then these two conditions need to be satisfied. If less than, then these two. Otherwise, answer. This is the I handled it extra. So now let's move on to problem B. So basically, here you have to just there are n numbers given, and you have to choose the second number, that is the exit number you have to choose, and from that you just need to iterate over the numbers in the as the values AI and choose those numbers, and just you need to find the value of those. So suppose there is nothing sort of explaining in that. This is just the implementation question. Let me just write it. So suppose you are given as 4, 1, 3, 2, 5 like this, and now suppose the value of x is has been given to you as 3. So now let's change it to 4. Suppose x has been given to you as 4, so you would go to fourth position. That is, you would choose 2. Then you would go to second position, you would choose 1. Then you would go to 1th position, you would choose again 4. And now, since you have already taken this second value, the process here stops. So it's just an implementation question, and you have to rather jump from the value given as AI. So this jump to code. That is, I just inputted the values. This is the Boolean array that stores what positions I have visited. So first of all, this exit position, which I am denoting here as M, that would be definitely 1. And then I have stored the value present at this position 1, and then I would be jumping. That is, if I move to such a position that has not been visited before, then I would mark that value as 1. Then this is the process of jumping. That is, I would be associating M is equal to ARM, increasing the counter. And if I had reached at a position where I have already selected that position, then I would just break and just output the total answer. That is, CT was from this and 1 was from this that I have initialized before. So CT plus 1. So this also has been done. So from C, the questions are a bit good. Let's start. So basically, here you would be given with a matrix of n comma 3, and where these three values represent for every person what the person has scored in the first three tests or games. You could choose anything, and you have to tell if the player playing or the game on the fourth day can be in the top k ranks or not. That is given here. So let me directly explain the solution. Come on, clear canvas. Yeah. So suppose you just count the sum of all the players, that is n comma 1, sorry, I comma 1, I comma 2, and I comma 3. You sum these three values and just store it in some container, like a pair of sum comma position. Now, what you would just check that if on fourth day, if adding 300 points to any player can move it to top K positions or not, that I have to implement only. And this could be easily implemented by lower bound function if you have heard it in binary search. That is, I would be storing all the sums from this matrix which I would be given with, that is I comma 1, I comma 2 and I comma 3. This I would be storing for every I, and then after that I would be adding 300 points to all the values and would check that on adding these 300 points, can I reach to position less than equal to k, that is in top k ranks. So let's just move to code. So this is the matrix which I would be taking as input. This I am taking input and calculating all the sums and putting it in a container, that is sum comma I. That is, I would be calculating the sum for all the 3 days for all the ith values, and then I would be sorting it in descending order, which is done by this CMP function. That is, if the first value is greater than the second value, then it would return true, otherwise false. So this is comparator, so it would be used to sort the values in descending order. And then I am just making it use local vector so that I could easily implement a binary search that is lower bound on it, because I could implement that on a pair of values as well, but its code is little bit complicated. So it's easy to just create another container and store all the values in this. So I would be sorting this in ascending order. So this is just as it is. Now, if this is just a simple counter that would be increasing for every number of iteration, and if that number is less than equal to k, that is if the position I dot second, which I am storing here, could see the position of ith variable, and as I am sorting it again, the positions would got have randomly placed. So if that current value is less than equal to k, then that I would set as 1. This BR is just that Boolean type array you could assume that would be storing the position the whose values I can achieve in top k ranks and not. So then I would be adding lower bound and add 300 plus and 301. This I would be adding because it is given in the question that after the fourth day it is possible. Where it is given? Just 1 second. Yeah, dice in top k after the fourth, it is possible that dice are in top k ranks, and the condition for which it was given here should be higher. Yes, fourth days are higher than that of the student. So for to get the values as higher, because you know that if there are multiple values which are suppose I have 100 and some values are there also, and then after adding 300 I have multiple values, that is 400, 400, 400. It doesn't matters to me, as lower bound always gives me first value. So it would give me false results if suppose there are many 400 values, that then the k value could have been exceeded. So I would directly suppose there is a value 401, so I would directly make it to reach this position and hence can easily count these. So I'm adding 301 to this value, and then I would be just this is the starting pointer I would minus. Then I would just check that as this vector is sorted in ascending order, it would be given the last, so I would be subtracting it, and that this plus one is just given in the question, the student plus one. So I would be just checking is it less than equal to k. If it is yes, then the answer for that particular value would be 1, otherwise no. So this is just that. I hope you got the point. So now let's move to question D. You would have already read the question, but let me just iterate it over here in the whiteboard. Yes. So basically, what you would be given, you would be given with a q number of queries, where you would be given with number 1 and any number, so say xi, and 2 any number say xi. Now what you have to do, you are given with a constant n. Now you take this value as h now, and then ah mod n equal to, you have to make this value put xi for that xi which is not equal to minus 1, and till that point you have to increment this h value by 1. Suppose h value came to be 2, and then 2 modulo n, that is a2 was not equal to minus 1, that is a2 had any value which was not equal to minus 1, so you would increment this h value by 1, so 1. This comes out to be 3. Then you would check a3 mod n, Suppose A3 was also not equal to minus 1. So like this you would be incrementing plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. And then mark that value as equal to this current value, which is xi. And then for the second query is just the is just for printing the output. That is, you would take this xi, mod it with the n, that is xi modulo n, then gen directly print the value, suppose array of this index. Just this you didn't have to print. So basically you could implement this question directly with brute force also, and with a container called set. So for the brute force, this could have exceed the time limit because the total number of numbers are n is equal to 1e6. And now suppose for every number you got query from 1 and 2, then you just iterated from 1 till, suppose from 1 till n minus 3, all the values were not equal to minus 1, and you were asked and the h value given was equal to 1. So you did a1 modulo n, which was a1, which was not equal to minus 1. Then you incremented it by 1, it came out to be a2, a3, a3 till a4 till n minus 3. Now you iterated till n minus 3, and then for the n minus 2th value you got to know, oh, that a of n minus 2 is equal to minus 1. Then you would put a of n minus 2 as the value xi. But this would this is definitely an n square logic. So to optimize this, it's not pretty hard to see that you could maintain a set of all the numbers. Suppose you have a set that contains all the values from 1 till n, rather from 0 till n. And then what you would do is that, suppose the you got query for 2, then you would check that if this number, that is 2 modulo n, exists or not. If this exists, you would definitely directly put this value x as xi. This set stores all the numbers for which the values are minus 1. So a2 is there in the set. So that means a2 is equal to minus 1 till now. So you would just remove a2 and put it xi. Now you would erase this element. Now suppose the set, my set looks like this for now. 0, 1, 7, 8, 9 and till n. That is, from all the values from 2 till 6, all have values which are not equal to minus 1. So now you get h as equal to 3. You did 3 mod n, which came out to be a3 only. Now you check that a3, the next element is 7 only. So it is not possible. So you incremented it a4, a5, a6. And since you are incrementing it by one, you would directly see that for the next value, which is greater than 3, you could all directly use this value and give this value as equal to xi, which was given with this value 1. That is 1 comma xi. So, and then after that, you would be just removing this element. Now, this operation can be easily performed in set using the lower bound function, which is directly present in the set library and could be implemented using log n. That is already implemented, that's why. And you have to remember one more point also, that in the set value, in the lower bound set, which is built in its function, works in log n. But if you use this function which I used in suppose this value, this lower bound of whole vector, this can sometimes lead to an O of n runtime complexity. So always remember that for the set function there is an inbuilt function for lower bound that you should always use. So now let's jump to code. I just defined the n as a constant and then declared this is just the DP array, which would be used to display the values when the query would come out to be 2 comma xi types. So firstly, I would be initializing all the values with minus 1, and then I would be inserting all the values in the set. Then for each query, if this query is equal to 1, I would find the next greater value, that is k mod n, next greater than or equal to value. If this value equal to n, suppose let me come out to this. Suppose the values were like this, n minus 2, n minus 1, and n. And now this a h mod n came out to be equal to n minus 1. And suppose n minus 1 was not present in the set, then it would directly come out to n. But as we know that a of n mod n equal to 0 as by incrementing n minus 1 by 1, it came out to be n. So n mod n equal to 0. So my pointer has to get to from the top again. So that is why this condition is being implemented here. So if this pointer has reached the last value, then I would just make it to the beginning and then just erasing it and using it for my value. Otherwise, if that's not the case, then just directly use this value, that is star it, and put this as k and then delete. And if this value a is not equal to 1, that is a equal to 2, then just simply you have to print the output. So D question was not that hard in this contest, so I think you would have done it. So now let's move on to problem E. So basically, I would tell you one or two more things in problem E, which you would be very useful. I would be telling its whole proof. So it might be a bit long, but it would be more beneficial for you to see the whole proof. And then you could remember also this, as it is a pretty nice identity. So I think you would have easily gotten the solution for this problem. The main thing is in its implementation. So firstly, tell me, I would be telling it to you its logic, and then I would be telling you one CACS problem from which you would get some motivation to solve this, and one more insight which is present in this problem only, through which many wrong answers were coming to me also. So let me just tell you the logic first of all. So basically, there are n numbers given, and any number can go from 1 till k. So first let me talk about this. So as any number can go from 1 till k, for every number I have k possibilities, k, 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 k. So total number of sequences that can be available are k raised to the power n. Now, for every sequences that are there, that is k raised to the power n sequences, for every sequence I can assign any value from 1 till m. For this also m values, for this also m values, this also m values, and there are total of k raised to the power n sequences. So total number of possible occurrences would be m raised to the power k raised to the power n. So for many of you who know binary exponentiation, you must have thought that let me just directly do it, suppose calculate power of k to raise to the power n modulo some mod, and suppose if this value comes out to be suppose j, then after calculating this value, then again calculate this value, that is m comma j comma mod. But this approach is fully wrong, because this can be shown by an example also. Let me just have an example in front of you. Let's say you have 2 raised to the power 3. So, and you have to find this value modulo 5. So let me take out first by normal method, that is 2 raised to the power 3, which is 8. So 2 raised to the power 8, which is 256, modulo 5, which comes out to be 1. Now, if you go by this logic, that is, you would do 2 raised to the power 3 modulo 5. Then after calculating this value, you would again be doing modulo 5. So 2 raised to the power 3 modulo 5, which gives me 2, then this values come out to be, then 2 raised to the power 3 comes out to be 8, then 8 modulo 5 gives me 3. So you would see that the answer fluctuates, and hence this logic is definitely wrong. So I would be proving this whole thing, and I would be using Fermat's little theorem. If you know that thing, it's good. Otherwise, I would also be telling its proof fully, so that you remember it, and whenever you are using it, you don't have any doubts in your mind that how it is working. So suppose I have this value m raised to the power k raised to the power n. So for further explanation, I would be using the Fermat's little theorem, which says that for any integer a co-prime to some integer p, that is their GCD should be 1, and a prime number p, this should hold, that is a raised to the power p minus 1 should be congruent to 1 mod p. First of all, I would be showing you this proof, and then I would be using it to find this value. Now, as we know that x1 plus x2 raised to the power p can be written as pc0 x1 raised to the power p x2 raised to the power 0 plus pc1 x1 raised to the power p minus 1 x2 and so on till the last value which would come out to be pcp x1 raised to the power 0 and x2 raised to the power p. So this value doesn't contains any multiple of p, and this value also doesn't contain a multiple of p. And this I can prove it like this. Suppose for any value PCR where p is a prime number, I would be writing it down like this, p into p minus 1 into something, and in denominator also there would be something. Now since p is a prime number, it would not have any multiple which is definitely divisible by p. So I would claim that in PCR there would be p always present. So this I could suppose say that x1 raised to the power p plus x2 raised to the power p plus some multiple of p. Therefore, I can say that x1 plus x2 raised to the power p gives me x1 raised to the power p plus x2 raised to the power p modulo p. And as this value holds out for these two values, I could do it for multiple values. Suppose I am doing till a values, that is x1 plus x2 plus x3 up till xa raised to the power p. So this value would come out to be x1 raised to the power p plus x2 raised to the power p till xa raised to the power p mod p. Now I would assign all the values equal to 1, that is x1 is equal to x2 till xa is equal to 1. So LHS would become these are a values total, so this would become a raised to the power p, and since 1 raised to the power p is also equal to 1, so this would become a mod p. So now further breaking it down, I have a raised to the power p is equal to kp plus a, that is there is some multiple of p and the remainder has been left out as a. So I would be taking this in the LHS, a raised to the power p, this gives me out as a raised to the power p minus 1 minus 1 is equal to kp. Now since p is a prime number, that means this a would definitely be divisible by this k. So what I would do is that I can definitely write it down this again as a raised to the power p minus 1 minus 1 is equal to some q times p. So that means this value is definitely divisible by p. So a raised to the power p minus 1 is equal to qp plus 1, which gives my result as the above equation which I wrote down. That is actually Fermat-Seidel theorem. A raised to the power p minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod p. Now how this would be used to find this value? So suppose m raised to the power k raised to the power n, can I am taking this value modulo p raised to the modulo p minus 1, that is k raised to the power n modulo p minus 1. So if this value can be written down as k raised to the power n can be written as q into p minus 1 plus r, where q is some quotient and this is some r. Now as this value is divisible by p minus 1, so my this would become q into p minus 1 plus r. So this can be broken down again, as you would know that mod follows the addition, subtraction and multiplication property directly. I could easily write it down this as m into q raised to the power minus 1 into m raised to the power r. Now on taking the modulo with p minus 1, this value would come out to be 0. Let me write it down this again in the explanation format. So as this is a prime number, so a raised to the power p minus 1 gives a modulo p gives me 1. So this is 1 raised to the power q into m raised to the power r. So this value comes out to be m raised to the power r modulo p. That is, and r, as you know, it is already the remainder obtained by using modulo p minus 1 with k raised to the power n. So instead of doing k raised to the power n mod a while calculating the power function, you just need to use this mod as mod minus 1. And after that, you could easily calculate this value by using it again in this value, that is m raised to the power j. And here you would be using as usual mod, which is given as here. Now, there is one catch in this question also, which I would be explaining it in very detailed manner by giving you one more question. So here we have this question called exponentiation 2, So basically, here you also need to do the same thing. That is, you need to calculate a raised to the power b raised to the power c, but modulo 1 e 9 plus 7. And the catch here in this question and in that question was that here the modulo value, here the modulo value is definitely greater than the values given as a, b, c. So the case which is the case of having values as a mod m equal to 0, that is a modulo mod equal to 0, would not occur here, and hence this condition should not be checked here. But in the case for e, that is the problem, this problem here, the values are till 1e18, so I could have the cases where this value m modulo mod equal to 0, then in this case I need to return 0 only. So with this extra condition, this question could easily be solved. Now let's jump to code directly. So just I'm taking the three input variables. If I'm checking if this value is modulo mod is equal to 0, then just directly return 0. Otherwise, just use k raised to the power n and calculate it via modulo mod minus 1. And after the calculating this value and storing it in j, just do directly m raised to the power j modulo mod. And this is the cal power function, which is just the binary exponentiation function. And this is just the mod value. So I think I have completed all, and so thank you.